الحمد لله رب العالمين، الحمد لله ذي الملك والملكوت ذي العزة والجبروت، الحمد لله حي قيوم لا ينام، عزيز لا يضام، قهار لا يرام، وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له، وأشهد أن محمدًا عبده ورسوله. اللهم صلِّ وسلِّم وبارِك على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم تسليما. يقول الباري سبحانه وتعالى بعد أعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم: يا أيها الذين آمنوا اتقوا الله حق تقاته ولا تموتن إلا وأنتم مسلمون. Or you who believe, fear Allah as he should be feared, and die not except on the state of Islam. For may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the most merciful, bestow upon us the gift to die on the state of Islam. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to accept our fasting, our qiyam, and our invocation and dua. And may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala make us among those who have been freed from the hellfire in this blessed month of Ramadan. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in the beginning, toward the beginning of Surah Ali Imran, was instructing the believer to what will be best for them and what will be best, in fact, for the muttaqeen. قَالَ أُنَبِّئُكُمْ بِخَيْرٍ مِّن ذَلِكَ مِّن ذَلِكُمْ. Should I tell you what is better than all of that? And what all of that, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned before it, mentioned what has been beautified to the human being by their nature, the love of a lot of desires, including that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in this particular ayah, the women, the children, the accumulation of gold and silver, and you know, the lofty rights like the horses and the crops and so on. And all of that, if someone desired them in the way of the halal, not only subhanahu wa ta'ala will bless him and bless her in them, but Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will increase you also in reward. But Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala instructed the believer to not really dwell on such a thing, because when someone finds comfort in those desires of this worldly life, then he is missing from the true path, and then he will not be thinking to really build the next steps. So for this reason said, should I tell you what is greater than all of that for the pious one, which is me like his, and the instruction you have to be from the pious to receive all this blessing from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, which is the gardens beneath with, you know, river will be flowing, and you know, pure spouses, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the greatest of the thing, qala wa ridwanun min Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and pleasure from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Now, when Allah was describing this pious, He was describing their munajat, their dua. قَالَ أَلَّذِينَ Those. So this muttaqun is instructing for us when you're reading and you want to be from these true ones, from these truthful ones, from those who are Allah described them in His Quran that they're going to get His pleasure. قَالَ أَلَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ So those who are saying, and are saying يَقُولُونَ فِي الْمُضَارَى, which is like constantly saying. Amazingly, the first thing that they uttered, that they said, after acknowledging and embracing fully and completely with the confirmation of the iman, of the faith, and of the tawheed, of the oneness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the first thing that they said, O our Lord, forgive our sins. أَلَّذِينَ يَقُولُونَ رَبَّنَا إِنَّنَا آمَنَا Those who said, O our Lord, we have believed, then forgive our sins and shield us from the doom of the hellfire. Now, the question here is like this great people, this noble one, this pious, who have been pleased by Allah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept them in His pleasure. The first thing that they said after showing their identity, which are, we are a believer, oh Allah, forgive our sins. We say forgive our sins, the forgiveness, it's subhanAllah, is an ibadah that most of the people, they do not really appreciate it or hold it as the right esteem that it should be held for. Because when we're talking about forgiveness, everyone thinking about sinning, then forgiveness. When Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, He elevated the level and the status of the forgiveness to the point to be the best dua in Laylatul Qadr. In the night of power, Laylatul Qadr is the best dua. As a matter of fact, Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, when she asked the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, what will be the dua that I should be doing in Laylat al-Qadr, he said, ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He is al-Kareem, al-Afu, the one who loves to pardon you, to forgive you. Therefore, we understand that the status of the forgiveness is not limited to the forgiveness of the sins. It's something greater. So how the believer, you know, should take a path or have an understanding to elevate the status of the forgiveness in our heart to be one of the greatest objectives, if it's not the highest objective in your life. The highest objective. Because you find out later that the forgiveness is the heart of the servitude, that the forgiveness is the condition of the piety, that the forgiveness is the path to the salvation and to the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So it's not only forgiven sins, with someone that he has erased them from his record. And when someone gets used to the forgiveness in the way that they should be done, because some people, as Al-Imam Ali radiallahu ta'ala an, it has been narrated that he said to someone, when he saw someone asking forgiveness, he told them, your way of forgiveness require forgiveness. Which is mean, people, they ask forgiveness and maybe their eyes, you know, playing around, and they are not fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and that forgiveness is not counted, and that forgiveness requires forgiveness, as he said radiallahu ta'ala anhu. But we're talking about the forgiveness, that it becomes a characteristic, you know, of a behavior, a character in the believer, to be one of the pious ones that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, like those who mentioned in Ali Imran, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala added after enumerating one of the great virtue of the truthfulness, of the devotion. He said, قَالَ وَالْمُسْتَغْفِرِينَ فِي الْأَسْحَارِ, and those who ask forgiveness during the time of the Sahar, which is the right time after, before the Fajr. And he said it also in Surah Al-Dariyat, about those who are going to be gifted with the Jannah, and will be overwhelmed and happy with what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala offered them. He said, قَالَ إِنَّهُمْ كَانُوا قَبْلَ ذَلِكَ مُحْسِنِينَ. These noble ones, they were like muhsineen before in the dunya. They used to, subhanAllah, قَالُوا كَانُوا قَلِيلًا مِنَ اللَّيْلِ مَا يَهْجَعُونَ. They used to sleep a little. When you say sleep a little, people who stand and make their prayer on time for Isha and prayer on time of Fajr. قال وَهُمْ بِالْأَسْحَارِ يَسْتَغْفِرُونَ. And the time of the Sahar, they make an istighfar. So it becomes like a character with which Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is complimenting these noble ones. Complimenting this noble one. So when you think about it, he said, how can I do in a way to really elevate the status of the forgiveness to be some objective that when I do, you know, that is in my heart. So when I ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgiveness, it's not in a casual way, say, yeah, oh Allah, forgive me. No, in something, you know, deep. So we need like an understanding of the realm and the sphere of the forgiveness in more comprehensive way, and in the same time in more profound way. Because when you say, oh Allah, forgive me, what you're saying is something so big. But are you understanding that is big? Are you feeling that all what you need? Because when you come to Laylatul Qadr and we do not have this sense, then we're going to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala with the weak heart, with the less concentration, that we will not be able to elevate it more. Why? Because we do not have the understanding of the true meaning of the forgiveness. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created every human being on the fitrah, on their natural disposition, white, innocent, free of any sin. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revealed on His Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as He said in Hajjat al-Wada', قَالَ تَرَكْتُكُمْ عَلَى الْمَحَجَّةِ الْمَيْضَاءِ, I left you with the white evidence. The white evidence, I mean, is clear each night like each day, which is the Qur'an and the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The way to cleanse the fitrah, because our natural disposition, our clean and free and sinless fitrah, it has been invaded with all, subhanAllah, the way that is growing, the life, the background, the culture, the bad assumption, the wrong saying, the crooked the beliefs, all of them, subhanAllah, the study they're teaching you, all the things, subhanAllah, is corrupting the fitrah. The way how to cleanse it, we have to go back to the white evidence, which is the Quran and the guidance of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam. Now, in the guidance of the Prophet and the guidance of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, of course, who is being, you know, revealed to His Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, there's what we talk called, you know, the action of the body. And the action of the body will be the behavior, the conduct, and so on. And then the action of the heart, which is going to be the action of you, the truthfulness, of confidence, of the love of Allah, and the belief, and so on. Between these two actions, the heart and the body, the link between them is the intention. The link between them is the intention. Why we say the intention? Because the intention is going to have the action to be good, and that good action is going to have effect on cleansing the heart. And if the heart is not good, which is usually the heart, it's the engine of the action. But someone, for example, he's in crooked way, and his intention to make tawbah, repentance, Allah accept them, and by accepting them, cleanse their heart, and their heart will be then producing and guiding for a good action. And this intention, which is, if it's good, then everything is going to help this person be cleansed. So what is the role of the forgiveness here? The role of the forgiveness is a process of cleansing. So it becomes like someone, every time he asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgiveness, not anymore, you know, about the sin that they have done, but a forgiveness to cleanse that fitrah, that natural disposition, to regain back the process or that status of naqawa, of cleansiness, of purity. And that purity will help you to persevere on the path of uprightness. Therefore here, when you're thinking about the aspect related to this fear of the forgiveness, the first one, when you think about your fitrah, so you have a task, you have a role, you have a mission, how can you avoid your fitrah, your natural disposition that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala created you with, to be corrupted by the invasion of everything around you, from what you see and what you hear and what you read and what you think and what they impose you to think by the manipulation they're doing and so on. So that process, a cleansing, comes with the tool of the istighfar. So you see here, then we have the role of the forgiveness. Asking Allah forgiveness is a process of a cleansing. It's like a fuel that you keep cleansing your fitrah with. So to come to this point, we have to first have some element related to the istighfar to understand. The first one is, we have to know that the forgiveness is not restricted to committing sins. That's the first thing. The forgiveness is not restricted to committing sins. And when someone asks Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgiveness after committing a sin, the intention and the objective should not be also restricted in removing the sin. Which is be like someone commits a sin, he said, "Ya Allah, forgive me." So Allah forgive me, then that's it. You know, I forgive about that sin. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has erased it from my record. No. The objective need to be is how to restore yourself to the path of uprightness. So when someone fall into the sin, the intention of the forgiveness or the goal of the forgiveness is not just to erase the sin, but to come back to a better way before you commit the sin. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us, actually in the condition of accepting Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala your repentance, قال إنما التوبة على الله للذين يعملون السوء بجهالة ثم يتوبون من قريب. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will grant and accept the repentance for those who commit the sin out of, you know, ignorance. And the ignorance here, weakness, the ignorance, the absence of the greatness of Allah in one's heart. But this person, he's upright, he's good, he's a believer. Then when the person tripped, fell, what he going to do, the condition for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept him to come to run back to do it. So to run to correct. So you see here the role of the forgiveness in an auto-correction. Not someone like he's far and he's doing sin, ask forgiveness, and then he's doing another sin, he wait like, you know, a week or two or a month to ask forgiveness. That person, he already sank or like drowned into the darkness. He's far from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We're talking about a person who's on the path of uprightness. You know, the forgiveness is going to be auto-corrected. And the condition of that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned also the Quran, that forgiveness need to be followed by action of goodness, of islah, of correcting. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in many ayat of the Quran, the example of which I mentioned in Surah An-Nahl, قَالَ ثُمَّ إِنَّ رَبَّكَ لِلَّذِينَ عَمِلُوا السُّوءَ بِجَهَالَةٍ ثُمَّ تَابُوا مِنْ بَعْدِ ذَلِكَ وَأَصْلَحُوا إِنَّ رَبَّكَ مِنْ بَعْدِهَا لَغَفُورٌ رَحِيمٌ. Your Lord, for those who commit sins out of ignorance, out of not knowing it's not a sin, but out of weakness. And then they write them, right after they ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgiveness, and they commit into correction in action of goodness, in action of correcting what they have done. So the objective of the forgiveness after committing a sin, and also again the forgiveness is not restricted to the committing of the sin, it needs to be how can you restore your path back, your path of the uprightness, that you get back on the right path. So here the sin is a fall and the forgiveness is to get back. If you remember, we were talking about the path of the Hanafiya, the way of Ibrahim, to be inclined from every crooked way. So when you hurt a crooked way, the forgiveness comes as a tool to get you back. And whenever way you're going to really incline from it, with the forgiveness you get back to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the first element. The second element, the absence of forgiveness. When someone does not ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness, and without committing a sin. So not asking Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness, someone is praying, mashallah, he's fasting, he's doing everything. He didn't commit any sin, but he does not ask forgiveness. Why? Because of being distracted, being heedless. So this is what is going to happen. It's going to lead to what is being called al-ghaynu ala al-qalbi. Al-ghayn al-qalbi. What is al-ghayn? Is a cover that gets into the heart. A cover that gets into the heart is not cover of sins, but cover of heedlessness. And this cover of heedlessness, it can lead to the impurity of the heart. Why? Because someone will be slowly desensitized. Their perception will be, subhanAllah, kind of corrupted by what everything happened around them. So there will be really a trap and easy prey for the normalization. People, they say, talk about things every day. And you know it's a sin, you know it's haram. Tomorrow is going to become less haram. After tomorrow is going to be okay. And then you're going to become enthusiastic, you know, to help people. We are inclusiveness. SubhanAllah. This is because the absence of the forgiveness. The Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he is the best of the creation. قَالَ إِنَّهُ لَيُغَانُ عَلَى قَلْبِي يُغَانُ. He said, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is indeed, I have my heart who's inflicted by this ghayn. But the ghayn of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam is totally different from ours. I mean, ghayn, he said, you know, like covering kind of a small ghafla, an instant ghafla. So what he said, قَالَ وَإِنِّي لَأَسْتَغْفِرُ اللَّهَ فِي الْيَوْمِ مِئَةَ مَرَّةٍ. Then I'll ask Allah forgiveness in the day 100 times. Therefore, dear brother, respected sister, the absence of the forgiveness, regardless of committing sin, and this case not committing sin, is going to lead to the ghayn of the heart, is going to lead to the desensitization, is going to lead to be an easy prey to the normalization of what things happen or the shaitan is trying to manipulate the society with. And then a person will be coming to a state, لَا يَعْرِفُ مَعْرُوفًا وَلَا يُنْكِرُ مُنْكَرًا. Come to the state, he does not know what is the good and what is not know the evil, because his heart and her heart is not able to discern, to make the differentiation. You know, everybody saying this is good, so it becomes that good because everybody is saying so. The second element is when you do the istighfar, it has a very powerful way to make you servant of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Because the forgiveness, its role, it helps you to know who you are. It reveals to you the true reality of yourself. You are a weak person. You are a poor person. You are a person in need. So when you keep making the istighfar, you're always begging Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to help you have more humility, to help you have more devotion. So the istighfar is a process of increasing in humility. Because when someone makes the istighfar, it helps them know who they are. And one of the great saying of one of the arifin, قَالَ مَعْرِفَتُكَ مَنْ أَنْتَ قَاعِدَتُكَ الَّتِي لَا تَنْهَدِمْ وَسَكِينَتُكَ الَّتِي لَا تَزُولُ. Knowing who you are. And this is required a great comment in it. I mean, farther comment in it. Knowing who you are is your structure and your foundation that will never break. And it's your tranquility that it will never come to an end. As it has been said, and it's not a hadith, whoever who knows himself or herself, they know their Lord. من عرف نفسه عرف ربه. And Imam al-Nawawi, he commented in that, he has a comment on it. He said, رحمه الله تعالى, said, the more you know how weak you are, the more you know Allah, how great and strong He is. The more you know how poor and in need you are, you know, the more you know how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, He's the all-rich, the all-independent, the all subhanahu wa ta'ala, have everything. The more you are in need, in weakness, the greater you know how Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is powerful. So, ma'rifatun nafs, knowing yourself, is going to help you really have that humility. For this reason, Imam al-Hasan al-Basri, it has been narrated, he said, when I traveling to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I came from many gates to enter to Allah, and I found them all crowded, except one gate. It was almost empty. The people around it, they are few. And it was the gate of al-inkisar lillahi. Al-inkisar is to show full and complete humility to Allah. I went to the gate of the prayer. I found that a lot of people getting, you know, crowded to get to Allah through the prayer, through the fasting, through other action. But the way of the inkisar, it was almost empty. And this, the istighfar, is the tool that will inherit into your heart this complete humility of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Then look at the maziyah and the merit and the greatness of the forgiveness when you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness. Then when you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala for forgiveness, you're going to target cleansing back your fitrah. Restore back that, you know, that uprightness that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala already instilled in you from the time when you were born. And then the forgiveness is an auto-correction of your path. Not only cleansing the sin, but to just get you back to be on the path of Allah. The forgiveness also is going to help you to have that humility. Because when you have the humility, you're going to find yourself closer and closer to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The next one is the next one. One of the wisdom that someone comes from one question. The question is, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam instructed us to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgiveness after the worship. After you make wudu, as in the hadith of Abi Sa'id al-Khudri, you say, Subhanak Allahumma wa bihamdika ashadu an la ilaha illa ant astaghfiruka wa atubu ilayk. This is after the wudu in a hadith. After the salah, the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he taught us to say, astaghfirullah, Allah forgive me 3 times. After the Hajj, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned in the Quran, after the Hajj, which is mean like you just came out of Arafah like a newborn, restored, you know, clean slate. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling us in the Quran, قَالَ فَإِذَا أَفَضْتُمْ مِنْ عَرَفَاتِ فَاذْكُرُوا اللَّهَ عِنْدَ الْمَشْعَرِ الْحَرَامِ وَاذْكُرُوهُ كَمَا هَدَاكُمْ وَإِنْ كُنْتُمْ مِنْ قَبْلِهِ لَمِنَ الضَّالِّينَ ثم أفيض من حيث أفاض الناس واستغفر الله. And ask Allah for forgiveness. When you finish Arafah, you're gonna go to the Muzdalifah and just absorb this great experience. And while you are doing that and you're leaving that part, you're going to ask Allah for forgiveness. So what forgiveness for? You see? So the forgiveness is from increasing in level, in getting into the more humility, which is going to help us to understand. So what is the wisdom behind, like, you just prayed and you're going to say astaghfirullah, astaghfirullah. You make hajj and you say astaghfirullah. You make wudu and you say astaghfirullah. You make qiyamul layl and then you're going to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala astaghfirullah. Because al-mustaghfirin bil-ashar, at the scholar they said subhanallah, he's the whole night praying to Allah, and as soon as he's finished turning, ya Allah ighfirli. It's amazing. So the istighfar is that sweet connection with Allah. The istighfar in this element after the ibadah, one of his dalalat, one of his evidence, and one of his wisdom, first is that you're going to push the ujub from your nafs. What is the ujub? It's like, you know, that excessive pride. So when someone prayed and he think like he, alhamdulillah, he prayed, he look around him, who the people are looking, I just prayed. And subhanAllah, when you just finish the prayer and you say astaghfirullah, it gets you in a state like continuation of the humility after the salah. And then also it has one of the great evidence, which is to cleanse all the shortcomings that you have in your ibadah. It's either it was in hajj or in wudu or in fasting or in the salah and so on. But one of the other things which is very important is to help you contain yourself into the sphere of the humility and the devotion. Because the nature of the human being is, subhanAllah, to transgress. You're telling me transgress for a believer who just finished the prayer? Yes. How? Because when you feel close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you feel like, subhanAllah, you have kind of a pass from Allah. You feel elevated on people. You start to look down to people. I mean, you are the pious, you are the righteous person, and these people are all in hellfire. And that is the wrong thing to do. As a matter of fact, that is the tughyan. Because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala qala, kalla innal insana la yatgha idha in ra'ahu istaghna. When you feel like you are high, and you are like in high status, because now people in high status because they have power, like Abu Jahl and money. But this one, subhanAllah, the shaitan tricked him. He's after the salah, after the ibadah. He feel like, you know, great person. And there is a story, actually it happened, you know, many centuries ago. One of the scholars, he was traveling, and they going into with his student, and he came to a town where they were like all of them Christian, non-Muslim. And he looked at them with disguise, and he looked like this, these people like, you know, our pigs. These people are going to hellfire. SubhanAllah, by doing that, all the knowledge he has, he didn't have a modesty. All the knowledge he has, he didn't have the compassion in his heart to ask guidance for these people. Afterward, he didn't leave that town, but he saw a woman, and subhanAllah, it hit his eye. And the story ended up, but he changed his religion to marry that woman. He changed his religion to marry that woman. It's a true story. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accepted his repentance. He was one of the great scholars of his town. And his student who was reporting the story, he said he kept going back to him. Everybody, they forget it. Go back to him. He asked him, what happened to you? He said, I don't know. Then when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will for him the repentance, he told him the story. So, you know, after I said what I have said about these people, belittling them, looking to them down, thinking that I'm, you know, the closest to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I felt something that been ripped out of my heart and flew away. And I believe that was the faith. So you see, dear brother, respected sister, the fact to contain yourself into the path of the humility is so important, and you cannot have it to be done only with the forgiveness. So you see, when you ask in Allah forgiveness, you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to protect your iman, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase you in humility, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to increase you in your devotion, to not be like those who become like arrogant. Arrogant. And one of the amazing stories who help us to reflect on such a, on this element, this particular element, because many people, when they, subhanAllah, when they feel that they're close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they look, you know, everybody else is wrong. Everybody else is doing things. They see someone making sujood, it's wrong. Making wudu is wrong. His salat is wrong. They become, subhanAllah, the judge on people, when in reality they become arrogant, out of the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And what corrects that is the perseverance and persisting on the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ibrahim alayhi salam, after Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala saved him from the fire, he said, oh Allah, I'm going to Allah to guide me. And then right after he said, oh Allah, grant me of the righteous offspring. And here a question that the scholar they were been discussing. Ibrahim, when he's been saved, he felt like so overwhelmed happiness inside. Can you imagine? He's been saved from the fire. This is a miracle. In a very lesser grade, us, when you complete Hajj, when you complete Umrah, when you complete the night of Laylatul Qadr, you feel some overwhelm, subhanAllah. At that moment, you have to contain it, to turn it into humility. So here, the dua of Ibrahim, when he asked Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, ya Allah, grant me of your offspring. The question, is this dua for Ibrahim or for Allah? For Ibrahim, because he's overwhelmed, now he's going to rest, he's going to be distracted. I finish what I have to do. Alhamdulillah, now I want the offspring and to have fun and to have my family. Or an offspring to help them, also guide them to continue his path. That's why, subhanAllah, it came a very strong a trial to just have his son to be slaughtered. For us to know that this dua was for Allah, not for Ibrahim, for his own self. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said to his prophet, إِنَّ كَذَلِكَ نَجْزِي الْمُحْسِنِ. This is how we reward the good doers. And you are one of them. And that's how Ibrahim deserved the title to be the friend of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And that's how, on the path of Ibrahim and the path of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, that we should really think about these things. So the istighfar is a necessity to help you find that humility to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. To help you when you make the dua, you don't make them for you to just the gain of the worldly life, but to help you gain of the worldly life, who going to access better to the mercy of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And for this reason, we understand the hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, قَالَ طُوبَى لِمَنْ وَجَدَ فِي صَحِيفَتِهِ إِسْتِغْفَارًا كَثِيرًا. Said, felicity and glad tidings for those who find in their record a lot of forgiveness. And in the other hadith, قال, من أراد أن تسره صحيفته فليكثر من الاستغفار. Whoever who want to be joyful, happy when he will see his record in the day of judgment, he has to increase from the istighfar. And the Prophet also صلى الله عليه وسلم said, قال من أكثر من الاستغفار جعل الله له من كل هم مخرجا وَمِنْ كُلِّ ضِيقٍ فَرَجَى وَرَزَقَهُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَمْ يَحْتَسِبْ. Whoever who continue and persist and you do much of forgiveness, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will make for every sorrow a relief, for every difficulty a way out, and Allah will provide him and her from way they do not expect. And this one of the infinite blessing of the istighfar. أقول قولي هذا واستغفر الله لي ولكم فاستغفروه الغفور الرحيم. بسم الله وكفى والصلاة والسلام على النبي المصطفى أما بعد. الإمام الحسن البصري رحمه الله تعالى had a person asking him his question about what will be the best dua to ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to have children, offspring. He told him, go and ask Allah for forgiveness. The second one, he said, you know, we have lack of crops. What the best of the dua should I be doing? He said, go and ask Allah for forgiveness. The other person talking about, you know, the lack of the rain. He said, go and ask Allah for forgiveness. When he was asked, why are you telling them the same thing when everyone has his own, you know, it's totally different matter. He said, have you not heard in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Quran Nuh saying to his people, فَقُلْتُ اسْتَغْفِرُوا رَبَّكُمْ إِنَّهُ كَانَ غَفَّارًا يُرْسِلِ السَّمَاءَ عَلَيْكُمْ مِدْرَارًا وَيُمْدِدْكُمْ بِأَمْوَالٍ وَبَنِينَ وَيَجْعَلْ لَكُمْ جَنَّاتٍ وَأَنْهَارًا. And they told them, ask forgiveness from your Lord. Indeed, if you do so, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala send on you showering, you know, rain of abundant rain, and produce for you, you know, abundance of crops, and give you offspring, and make you, you know, gardens, and so on. This is the blessing of the istighfar. But the blessing of the istighfar requires the element that we have mentioned. The element when you ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgiveness, don't think about the sin. Think about all the elements that you want to increase into humility to Allah. You want to connect to Allah. You want to keep yourself in that path of the uprightness. You want to cleanse your fitrah. You want to keep correcting your path, cleansing your heart, and also cleansing your inner nature from all the invasion that we are, you know, witnessing in our life. The maghfirah is an introduction, as it is an end. If you look, you know, we don't have the time to tell you how many ayah in the Quran. All the prophets that say, Rabbana اغفر لنا, like Musa, قال ربي اغفر لي ولي أخي وأدخلنا في رحمتك وأنت أرحم الراحمين. Sulaiman, before he asked for the kingdom, he said, قال ربي اغفر لي وهب لي قال ملكا لا ينبغي لأحد من بعد. Those who were into the field that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala mentioned, in the field of the war, in the battlefield, they said, oh Allah, forgive our sins and all what we have done against ourselves. and give us firmness, and Ya Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us victory. So this is the introduction. This is the introduction. It's like the maghfirah is like an introduction to all your dua, an introduction to all your gift from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. As also it is the end, because the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, close to his death sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala sent to him Surah Al-Nasr. As Ibn Abbas, he said, this is like alerting the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam of the end of his life. قَالَ فَسَبِّحْ بِحَمْدِ رَبِّكَ وَاسْتَغْفِرْهُ. Imagine the end of the life of the Prophet, he's been ordained by Allah to ask for forgiveness. And then, dear brother, respected sister, what a beautiful dua that you're going to make, insha'Allah, and may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala together us, all of us in the Jannah, in the Day of Judgment, in the group of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, you will be walking and the light will be shining in front of you and on your sides. And you will be saying with the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us in Surah Al-Tahrim, رَبَّنَا أَتْمِمْ لَنَا نُورَنَا وَاخْفِلْ لَنَا إِنَّكَ عَلَى كُلِّ شَيْءٍ قَدِيرٍ. This is in the Day of Judgment. The only dua is, O Allah, perfect and complete our light and forgive us. You have power over all things. For dear brother, respected sister, may inshaAllah this element about the forgiveness to elevate the status of the forgiveness in our heart, and to make when we hear someone asking forgiveness, when we ask Allah for forgiveness, until we come to the day of the night of the power, we have an objective. The forgiveness elevated with this meaning to be one of the highest objective is not easy. The most valuable, the most beautiful, the most great objective in your heart to say, Ya Allah, forgive me. يا الله فارجبني ربنا ظلمنا أنفسنا وإن لم تغفر لنا وترحمنا لنكونن من الخاسرين. اللهم اغفر لنا ذنوبنا أجمعين ما علمنا منها وما لم نعلم دقها وشقها صغيرها وكبيرها. اللهم آتي نفوسنا تقواها وزكها أنت خير من زكاها أنت وليها ومولاها. اللهم آتنا في الدنيا حسنة وفي الآخرة حسنة وقنا عذاب النار. اللهم ربنا إننا آمنا فاغفر لنا ذنوبنا وقنا عذاب النار. ربنا إننا سمعنا مناديا ينادي للإيمان أن آمنوا بربكم فآمنا. ربنا فاغفر لنا ذنوبنا وكفر عنا سيئاتنا وتوفنا مع الأبرار. ربنا وآتنا ما وعدتنا على رسلك ولا تخزنا يوم القيامة إنك لا تخلف الميعاد. وآخر دعوانا أن الحمد لله رب العالمين. وأقم الصلاة يرحمكم الله.